One fateful day in the year 2000, a horrific crime was discovered in the town of Paramus, New Jersey, about an hour north of Princeton. In an old and boarded-up snack bar, police found the bullet-ridden remains of a young man who had been killed execution style, tied to a chair, heavily beaten up, and finally shot in a rain of bullets. The victim was identified as Matthew Bevilacqua, 24 years old, and already known to the police for a long record of petty crime. In the meantime, he had evidently climbed up in the world, for his murder was clearly the work of organized crime, a mob hit, ordered by someone who must have been pretty upset at him. In North Jersey, that could only mean the notorious crime boss, Tony Soprano. No killing of this style could have been staged without his knowledge and approval. Not that there would ever be any way to prove this. Not unless you had a witness. And even then, you couldn't tie it to him directly, as no mob boss was going to be foolish enough to involve himself personally in this kind of sort of business. And then, there was an unexpected breakthrough. A concerned citizen by the name of Larry Arthur stepped forward. On the night of the hit, he had a flat tire near that snack bar. While he was changing it, he heard the sound of gunshots, then saw two men running towards a car and driving off in a hurry. He might actually be able to identify them. Back in the police station, the detectives on the case gave him a binder with mugshots of the most notorious thugs in central and northern New Jersey. They couldn't believe their ears when Larry Arthur reached the page with Tony Soprano's mugshot and, without a beat, pointed at the picture and said, "That's him. That's one of them for sure."
"You have to be absolutely 110% sure this is who you saw."
"This is definitely the man I saw."
"Have you ever seen him before?"
"No."
"And the other man?"
"Unfortunately, I didn't get a good look at him. The light was reflecting off the windshield, but he was heavy set. It was really dark. I didn't want them to see me." "I heard gunshots, but I thought it was kids with firecrackers. And then when two men drove out in a car, I crouched down in the ragweed."
"Sure."
"It began to dawn on me. What had happened? And like I told the responding officers, I didn't finish changing the tire. I walked to a phone call right away."
"Thank you, Mr. Arthur."
"So goddamn fed up with crime. I'd hate myself if I didn't come forward and help you put these people behind bars."
"Thanks to people like you, we may just do that."
"May I ask who the dead man was?"
"Just a poor kid got hooked up with the wrong crowd."
"Crack?"
"Something like that."
When it begins to be reported by the news that a witness has stepped forward, the crime boss, Tony Soprano, realizes what a mistake he has made. This could do him in. But a few days later, the whole matter is resolved entirely to his satisfaction. Let's look at the final scene of the same episode.
Please, God, no.
What the hell is it?
The victim has now further been identified as Matthew Bevilacqua, a Soprano family associate.
Fuck, give me that. Officials close to the investigation are keeping tight-lipped, as it may involve a high-ranking mafia member.
Oh, my God.
Where's that detective's number?
On the fridge.
Those lying cocksuckers. Where on the fridge?
On the fridge, on the fridge!
Where on the fucking fridge?
I knew it! I knew it! But you had to be the big man!
The scene lasts only a little over 1 minute, but, like pretty much every scene in The Sopranos, this one was prepared and worked out with meticulous care. To appreciate this, it helps to know that the series dwells on an important distinction, one between people who are inside the mafia and who are almost without exception Italian Americans, and people outside it, the civilians. And those who are outside the mafia come in two categories. Broadly speaking, those with a college education and those without. Those without a college education are regular folk, people who are basically okay, at least as they are sensible enough not to get in your way. Look at this guy in the same episode. Good, earnest, hardworking Americans with a heart of gold. But educated people, boy, are they smug, pretentious, stuck up, holier than thou, pompous, superior, and condescending. And yes, you guessed it, Larry Arthur belongs in this category. To make that abundantly clear, no detail in this short scene is left to chance. Just take the opening panoramic shot. It begins with the encyclopedia there on the lectern, opened as though it were consulted every day. Obviously, it's just there for the show. The bookcase is more revealing. Once again, nothing is left to chance. These are not random books like you'll find on the shelves in the IKEA showroom. The titles alone show that Larry Arthur or his wife must be medical professionals. Gastrointestinal bleeding, highlights in psychological research, a calculus of suffering, pain, professionalism, and anesthesia in 19th century America, and a book called Great Jewish Men. And then there's the couple, the very image of domestic bliss. Another bookcase. A guitar, undoubtedly a relic from their college years in the 70s. A nice bottle of wine, cheap, but savored by a true connoisseur. A treatise on political philosophy. Why not? Yet it seems that the Arthurs are not a completely pretentious couple. The dress code in this household appears to be a simple beige and brown. In fact, when Larry visited the police station, his jacket and shirt were also beige and brown. And then there's the plaid throw blankets on the sofa that is decidedly unpretentious. Are they poor? Or do they just not care? But what on earth was that atrocious music they were listening to? Let's hear it again. Now, the clip I just showed you is also on YouTube with comments enabled. It will not surprise you that nearly all the comments are about the music. The visual cues, like the bookcase, the political theory book, the wine and the guitar, they are all important, but they are only preparatory. It's the piano music that must drive home the main point. This Larry Arthur may think of himself as an upstanding citizen, but all his pretensions to culture fly out the window once he realizes what he has done. And to see that happen is a satisfying thing to watch. But in order for us to take true delight in his consternation, we really need to hate the guy first. Let's hear some of the more outspoken comments. What in the fuck are they listening to? This is the worst music I've ever heard. I remember thinking that some pet or some small child was messing with the piano. I didn't even think that this was music. They need to slap that child for playing the piano like shit. What the fuck is that racket? Sounds like a couple of stray cats walking around on the piano keys. I like that cat. Jesus, sitting under a blanket reading some strange paperback book, sipping wine and listening to a fucking cat jump around on piano keys. Ugh, it figures they would listen to pretentious jazz music while reading. Makes me regret them not getting whacked in the show. Is this even jazz? Sounds like random notes, like that of a cat just walking over the piano. Horrid. Kid, it is jazz. It's pretentious fucking jazz music that's only good for helping snooty people believe that they're better than everyone. This isn't jazz. It's just dissonant fucking garbage. I wouldn't even classify it as music. Jazz is actually music. For some reason, many commenting here don't realize the music was the score for the scene. The music is symbolizing chaos and consternation. No, it's Anton Webern's Sehr Schnell, which is absolutely the shittiest piano score ever written. And here he is, the Austrian composer Anton Webern, who summoned all his creative powers to write this piece. Sehr Schnell means literally very fast. It's the middle movement of his Opus 27 called Drei Klavierstücke, three piano pieces. You heard that entire movement a moment ago. It lasts only about 35 seconds. And it takes up only one page in Webern's own handwriting. This looks like the work of a very, very meticulous man. Just look at how it says, between the stays for the left and right hand, F, P, F, P, F. And then at measure 4, P, F, P, then F, F, meaning very loud, and again back to regular F. By no means easy to play at fast speed. So, what is all this in aid of? What can I do as a professor to make our encounter with this piece educational and yet not pretentious? The first point I'd like to make is one I've been making throughout this semester, as far back as the very first lecture. When music is combined with an image, or the narration of a story, or a drama enacted on stage or in film, they somehow reinforce one another. Very powerfully so in some cases. In this way, they can merge into a single experience, in which things other than sound become somehow musical as well. Facial expression is the most obvious example. Remember the first lecture, when I showed the clip of the celebrity known as Emotional Baby. It's impossible to look at the clip and not be somehow convinced that she is picking up every emotional nuance of the song. Or the concerto for face and orchestra, in which the face tells the story of the music in the same wordless way that the music itself does. This makes it possible to manipulate music, to make it say certain things in ways that may affect us deeply and that we may be powerless to resist. I know from experience, 25 years of visiting movie theaters with my kids have given me a rich repertoire of musical stuff that I can draw on as a music professor. The film Marley and Me in 2012 seemed okay for about the first hour. But then the story took a sad turn, a very sad turn indeed, which in principle is also okay. But what has earned Marley and Me its place in movie hell is the treatment of that sad turn. The director clearly decided to milk it for all it was worth. And this is what I mean by powerless to resist. I know that dogs get ill and die, and that the death of a companion of, say, 15 years is a crushing loss. But this movie wanted me to weep over it, break down in tears, and start bawling over a dog I did not personally feel attached to. I felt that my emotions were being manipulated, and I felt trapped. Until, that is, I found the surefire remedy. I put my fingers in my ears and sat through the rest with indifference. If we apply that insight to the video clip from The Sopranos, it is obvious that we were being manipulated there as well. Every detail was carefully calibrated to accomplish just that, and the choice of Webern's piano piece was nothing if not inspired. But the challenge for us is to find a different way of using it, one that will highlight a different quality of the music. So let's leave Larry Arthur and his wife behind, find us a baby goat jumping merrily about, and all of a sudden it seems like we're in a different universe. Now, all this is well and good, but can we actually do this? Aren't we going against the composer's intentions, whatever they may have been? What if Webern expected us to contemplate abstract forms, like Eduard Hanslick said we should do in the previous lecture? Wouldn't he be right to insist that the music should make perfect sense to us when it is contemplated for its own sake? As it turns out, Webern himself associated his compositions with places and experiences. So we can actually try to hear his music like he heard it, and in that way be respectful of his intentions. Webern loved to hike in the Austrian mountains, went frequently on 2 or 3 day trips, usually alone. Far away from a world at war, a world in which the Nazis had forced him out of his job because of the music he wrote, and where he barely got by teaching piano lessons, with friends pressuring him to join the National Socialist Party, he was beyond all of that here. Neither rich nor poor, neither one political label nor another, for the duration of the hike, he was surrounded by mountains and accepted for who he was. Somehow these experiences, in the blazing brightness of the snow, must have left an indelible impression deep within him. We can tell this from his quartet for clarinet, saxophone, piano and violin, not part of our awesome mix, but a piece that does help us to appreciate the item by Webern that is included. The quartet is yet another composition that is very short. Throughout his life, Webern found himself composing music of ever greater concision, as if ultimately everything could be said with only a few notes. His own annotations in the sketches tell us that he wrote the music with different places of Austria in mind. You see them here marked in red: Annabichl, Schwabeck, Anninger, Dachstein. When we locate these places on the map, we notice how extensively he had explored his own country. And going back to the sketches, we see what images and impressions had remained with him. The coolness of the first spring, the first flowers emerging after winter, the highest pastures, then the Dachstein glacier, snow and ice, crystal clear air. And still there is more that catches his eye: the flowers of the highest regions, children playing on ice and snow, alpine roses, and finally the majestic outlook in the highest region. Did these impressions leave their mark in the music somehow? Perhaps. In the following slide, I have brought together the various passages for which he has provided such evocative descriptions. As much as possible, I've combined these with images of the actual places, or otherwise images that seem to match his descriptions. Let us hear what sense this music makes when we visualize the associations it had for Webern himself. But setting aside the inspiration from nature, the biggest and lifelong influence on Webern was the composer we encountered in the previous lecture, Arnold Schoenberg. Webern had been Schoenberg's student, and he worshipped his teacher as someone he regarded as almost a prophetic visionary. For some reason, Webern always chose to be near him. When Schoenberg moved to another place in Germany, he would soon start looking into moving there himself. And the truth is that there must indeed have been something magnetic about Schoenberg, a man of profound intellect and enormous learning, something warming about his presence, his words and his thoughts, at what seemed then like a critical moment in the history of Western music. No one was more conscious of just this, the historic significance of that moment, than Arnold Schoenberg. Music, as he saw it, and as many intellectuals at large saw it, is like an organism, like a tree, for instance. It starts life as a sapling, but it has an inner necessity to grow and develop along a certain pre-planned path. I speak of necessity because an organism can only evolve in one direction. It cannot reverse course, grow back, retract its branches and shrink to the young sapling it once was. The only thing we can do to fight its laws of biological necessity is by obstructing that path, as people do with Japanese bonsai trees, which are kept forever in a small pot, or simply to chop down the tree altogether. This is a useful analogy for how Schoenberg viewed music. He saw it like an organism, born with the potential of enormous growth. But none of its historical stages had unlimited potential. Sooner or later, a new stage would succeed another, just as surely as old branches would die off and new ones emerge higher up. In this way, the great German composers, Bach, Beethoven, and Wagner, had done what they did, as it were, in fulfillment of music's destiny. Schoenberg saw it as the composer's responsibility to do the same, to find a direction in which it was natural for music to develop, to discard old and exhausted potential, and discover new potential that might be opening up. That brings us to the crisis left by Wagner. By creating music in which cadential resolution was rarely or never heard, he sapped tonality of its cohesive power, the force of its gravity that held music together. After him, there was no going back. It was the end of tonality. Schoenberg had deeply internalized that lesson. And it is worth hearing another sample of his string septet, Verklärte Nacht, written on the cusp of the 20th century in 1899. It is ripe Wagner, like mature cheese shot through with deep veins of green bluish mold. You could use it in a scene of Hitchcock's Vertigo to hint ominously at suppressed desire. You could probably also use it in My Dog Marley to give the death of a family dog its full existential weight as irrefutable testimony to the ultimate meaninglessness of existence, and thus make us all weep at the whole universe as well as at the dog. Just kidding, of course. But when you hear just the first 2 minutes, there is an air of disconsolate sadness, as though Schoenberg were lamenting the very death of tonality, while still treasuring the last few gasps.
Thank you.
So, after Wagner, what does come next in history? What is the next phase in the story of music? And what new potential will there be for composers to explore? Schoenberg sensed that the honest solution was the most radical one. It was to do away with tonality altogether. That would be an easy thing to do if you decided to write music for percussion only. But Schoenberg wanted to hold on to all the instruments in the Romantic arsenal: piano, strings, wind instruments. So it was a matter of finding a new way to handle pitches, to have them make sense without relying on tonality. The only question was, what should come in the place of tonality? 10 years after Verklärte Nacht, in 1909, Schoenberg published the three piano pieces that are item 82 in the Awesome Mix. These are widely agreed to mark Schoenberg's first composition that is purposely atonal, without tonality. Let's hear the beginning of the first piece. Composing genuinely atonal music is more easily said than done. As a composer, Schoenberg is clearly working hard to give his musical phrases coherence, direction, cogency. But it is hard to figure out how to do that when at the same time you have to avoid any possible notion that you're still somehow dependent on tonality. And as it turns out, Schoenberg is not completely successful. It is possible to hear cadential progressions even in these avant-garde pieces of the early 20th century. Let's take that first phrase, marked A in the slide. Now, the left hand here plays two intervals that are almost octaves, but fall just one half step short. That is not a pretty sound. The right hand complements both intervals with a third note, turning them into three-note chords. But this, if anything, makes the sonorities even less appealing. It's hard to tell what's keeping all these notes together. But somehow they do. For example, the melody in the right hand doesn't jump all over the place in random or chaotic fashion. It makes a steady but sure descent, aiming straight for that final E in the last measure. This descent is counterbalanced by the upward motion of the accompaniment. So we have pure contrary motion here. The right-hand melody is given shape and fluency with conventional ornaments that you would expect in elegant piano music. But it is inherent in ornaments that you can take them away in order to see the underlying structure. And then what you're left with is a passage that may be atonal, but nevertheless has an extraordinary sense of direction. That sense is so assured that these arrows seem almost to point beyond themselves to some final sonority that is not heard but implied. And that final sonority is the goal that gives coherence to all that went before. A bit like the Tristan progression, which also implies a final chord but never gives it, at least not until the end of the opera. So here is one way of making sense of the chord progression. And with this jazzy cadence, we can hear the very tonality that Schoenberg was at such pains to avoid. Let's now hear it with the original. The third phrase, also marked A, is even easier to construe as a cadence. Let's first play the actual sample as we hear it in the Awesome Mix. And now, with the chord that seems to be implied. And if that is not quite jazzy enough, then how about this? Schoenberg's piano pieces, Opus 11, are examples of what is called free atonality. Free, because there is as yet no system to it, no rules that ensure atonality, but restrict compositional freedom. Chances are that you've actually heard free atonality just watching a movie on TV. There are movies that have completely atonal film scores, and I'd like to play you a brief example of two. The first is Rebel Without a Cause, featuring James Dean and produced in 1955. The 50s are the golden age of American cinema. Just seeing an American landscape in Technicolor takes me right back to my childhood years. And there is no black and white like 50s black and white. I could go on forever. But the film scores from this period are something else. How sad that more people don't buy them online and listen to them in the car. In the following clip, the famous knife fight at the planetarium, I've replaced the movie audio track with the score, keeping the exact timing of the original. Welcome to free atonality. And then the original Planet of the Apes from 1968. This time I've taken a somewhat quieter scene and have reinforced the movie audio track with the film score so that this dialogue can still be heard. Give it up for free atonality.
Is this the one you wanted, Doctor?
Yes, thank you. Bright Eyes, I've got a present for you. Put her in with him.
Time for some key concepts. First, atonal and free atonality. We have just discussed those. So that leaves us with two more concepts, serialism and 12-tone composition, and that will be the last major item on our agenda. To begin with 12-tone composition, This is the technique developed by Arnold Schoenberg to create atonal music in a more structured and disciplined fashion than in free atonality. These are two images from our textbook, illustrating and explaining the technique. What you see on the right are so-called tone rows or series. In 12-tone composition, these rows serve as the fundamental building material for atonal music. One row consists of all 12 tones in the octave, at least in the chromatic scale. The idea is that when you have played a tone, you cannot play it again unless you have played all other 11 tones first. And the row tells you in what order you play these. Variety is achieved by transforming the row in certain mechanical ways. The row itself is called prime, or P. When you play it backwards, that is, in reverse, then the letter is R. When you flip the series upside down, so that all ascending intervals become descending ones, and vice versa, it's called inversion, marked by the letter I. And finally, there is IR, which combines the letter two transformative devices. Now, this is all theory. But to learn the practice, we'll have to go back to the piece that we started today's lecture with, which was in fact composed with 12-tone technique. And those were the piano variations of Anton Webern, also known to some as a cat jumping about on the piano keys. How does Webern get from a prime row to the piano piece we heard in the household of Larry, Arthur and his wife? Here is the row in question. Now, the first thing that Webern does is rhythmicize it. His favorite way of doing that is by inserting rests between successive notes, as if to prevent us from hearing their succession as a melody, a tune. You'll notice, by the way, that there are a number of places where Webern does not insert a rest. Between notes 4 and 5, for example, and between notes 6, 7, and 8. But neither does he play them as a melody. Note 4 is treated as a grace note, which means that notes 4 and 5 are effectively a single musical event. The same is true of notes 6, 7, and 8, which are simply grouped in a chord. It's like they are molecules, whereas the other notes are single atoms. But the point is that they are all particles bouncing off of each other. This is what Webern is after: isolated notes or note groups, discrete events, freestanding notes, not communicating with what comes before or after. This is the very opposite of what we saw in Schoenberg, whose early piano piece showed such concern with a sense of direction, with notated or implied goals. And yet this rhythmicized version still sounds too much like a melody. So the next step is inevitable. Nothing could better illustrate Webern's intention of erasing any and every sense of melody, for no sooner has he cast his row in sprightly hiccups, or he starts shifting the notes to different octaves. A challenge for the pianist, especially with Webern's explicit instruction to play one note loud and another soft. And all this, as the title says, sehr schnell, very fast. So when we arrive at last at the finished composition, or at least the first six measures of it, we can trace the path of this first tone row by connecting the dots with red lines. So that is exactly one half of the music. But it still leaves another 12 notes to be accounted for. But now that we have seen the principle, it shouldn't be hard to trace the compositional path. The second tone row is the first row, but played in inversion. In other words, what went up now goes down, and what went down now goes up. There is nothing especially surprising about the rhythmic treatment of this inverted row. Once again, there is social distancing by the insertion of rests and social cohesion in the note groupings and grace notes. Finally, octave displacement and extreme differences of dynamics. And then, in the finished composition, the inverted row jumps its way around and about, below and above, left and right, before and after the first row. And to conclude all this, let's go to Maurizio Pollini and witness a very intense half minute performing the entirety of Sehr schnell. Our lecture has come more or less full circle. We started with Webern's piano piece as it was featured in The Sopranos. We observed that it easily sounds like rubbish when disagreeable persons pretend to take a delight in it, but that it gives a very different impression when it comes to a baby goat hopping merrily about. Also that Webern himself associated his music with visual impressions, and that he was the student of Schoenberg and followed him on the path beyond tonality into free atonality, and eventually 12-tone technique. Anton Webern was a shy and retiring man, mild-mannered and unassuming. But in his compositional work, he was quite undeterred by those in power who made life impossible for him, destroyed his career, and forced him to live away from Vienna. In 1938, the Nazi Party organized an exhibition in Düsseldorf entitled Entartete Musik, literally degenerate music. Among the placards on display, here was one specifically denouncing atonality and which vowed to do battle against those who propagated it. They were called charlatans. In the booklet accompanying the exhibition, Webern, among many other composers, was denounced as an artist who had betrayed his German race and heritage. The caption under his photo identified him as a master student of Schoenberg who had outdone his handler, it says literally animal trainer, by several nose lengths. We must take our leave from Anton Webern on a tragic note. What you see here is a panoramic view of Mittersil, the Austrian town where he lived the last few months of the war and the first few months after the collapse of the Third Reich. Unfortunately, he did not live to see the enormous influence that his music was going to exert on post-war composers. One evening in September 1945, he went out to take a few puffs of a brand new cigar he had been saving up just for a night like this. Since there was a curfew, he made sure to keep himself in the doorway. Yet, at this very moment, there happened to be an American army operation in progress. His sudden appearance in this very tense scene startled an American soldier, and before either could understand the other's intentions, he had already been hit by three bullets, which would prove fatal that same evening. Within years of his death, Webern would become the godfather of serialism and exert more influence even than Schoenberg himself. The idea of treating notes like atomic particles was soon picked up by young European composers. They extended this device of arranging pitches in rows to other note qualities as well, rows of durations, of loudness, of timbre, The chief protagonist of these developments was the French composer Pierre Boulez. Among his best-known compositions is Structure for two pianos, composed a mere 7 years after Webern's death. Just looking at the autograph score, you can tell Webern's influence. Almost every note has its own dynamic marking. A simple P for piano is not enough. There is PP, very soft, and PPP, very, very soft. And, not infrequently, PPPP, which I don't even know is possible to play on the grand piano. And there is a change of measure at every new measure, ironic for a composition called Structure. And it makes you wonder why he still held on to those last token vestiges of rhythmic regularity. Here you see the first page of the edition. And in a moment, we'll hear a 50-second sample of the composition. If you're not in the mood to listen to this, I don't know what I can do to change your mind. But right after this slide, the lecture will conclude with a little surprise having to do with Animal Crossing. My son is playing it every day here in Princeton, and over the weeks I've found that the songs of KK Slider are growing on me. I like one of them so much that I decided to make a piano arrangement, just for the heck of it. And that will conclude today's lecture.